and welcome to this latest edition of Breaking Down Barriers. This is a program where we look at the many different cultural and research stigmas globally that impact the Huntington's disease community, especially young people. And today we're going to be looking about the different misconceptions and misunderstandings when it comes to research, which is a very interesting and complicated topic. And you'll know that we've done this a few different times, whether we're looking specifically at different types of studies or providing our video that we actually released earlier in 2024, where we're looking at different ways of accessing research. But this is a really important piece to better engage and empower young people in the whole Huntington's disease community to make the best choices for them. So today I'm so thrilled to have two wonderful guests with me. We have Dr. Lauren Byrne and Dr. Kelly Atkins, who are esteemed scientists in Huntington's disease, as well as board members of HDYO. And I'll let them introduce themselves, and I'll start with Lauren.
Hi, everyone. I'm Lauren Byrne. I am a principal research fellow at the UCL Huntington's Disease Center, and I also come from a HD family. So my research is focused in biofluid biomarkers for Huntington's disease, and I'll probably talk a bit about what that is later. Also working with HDYO in developing what we call a registry, which we'll probably talk about a bit later, for juvenile HD.
Great. And Kelly?
Hi, I'm Kelly. I am a research fellow at the University of California in San Francisco, and I am a neuropsychologist by training. I trained back in Melbourne in Australia before moving to the US. My research has focused mostly on how we measure the cognitive changes and the psychiatric changes in Huntington's disease. And I am part of the, as well as that sort of research aim, I'm also on the board of HDYO and have been working heavily in our research committee with some of our surveys that we've been doing.
Awesome. Thank you both so much for being here. And I think it's always nice to just break the ice with this, but would love to know from each of you of what drew you to Huntington's disease. How did you get involved in the research aspect?
I guess I can start. So I mentioned before that I'm from a HD family. My family are based in Northern Ireland. My dad has Huntington's disease, and I kind of started thinking about getting involved in research when I was doing my undergraduate degree in biology. And I heard about this researcher, Sarah Tabrizzi, and that they were doing really cool research in UCL, which I was in London at the time. And I decided to go there, try and do a master's project to get into Huntington's. And that's where I met my previous boss, Ed Wilds, who some people know. And the rest is kind of history.
So just a little bit of, you know, some people that you know down the line after as you got started.
Yeah.
Kelly?
Yeah, I don't have the same connections as Lauren, but I similar though, I was doing my undergraduate degree in psychology in Australia. And you know, actually, originally, I wanted to be a clinical psychologist. I wanted to work sort of in the mental health space. And then I met a woman named Julie Stout. She was one of my lecturers in undergraduate. And she was a real expert in Huntington's disease. And I really admired her. And so when it was time to go and do my doctoral research, I chose to work with her. And she was the person that really introduced me to the HD community. I don't come from a HD family, but I've really enjoyed working in this space and feel very privileged to be able to be part of the community in that way.
I would just like to add that Julie Stout is like the expert in cognition in Huntington's disease. And so Kelly knows people. She knows us.
Yeah, for sure. That's also a big heavy hitter too.
She got connections.
Well, thank you both again for being here. And I think the first topic that I love to talk about is what are different kinds of research? And it's really hard because research is this huge umbrella of a word. And oftentimes we tend to go to these very formal structure type of research called clinical trials. And that's where we think of only where it matters to participate in research. But really there's this huge opportunity in so many different ways. So I'd love for you all to just take some time and help educate or refresh or remind people about the many different types of research opportunities that are out there.
I guess there's a few different ways to kind of start. You know, you can compare research with what we call basic science, which is anything on the lab bench. It might be working in animal models or cells or lots of things that way. And then we have human research, which is kind of the main focus of this discussion, and where we would ask, you know, participants that are human to come and do research in varying degrees of invasiveness or involvement. And what people know about, as Jenna said, mostly and probably are really interested in, is clinical trials, which are called clinical trials because of the fact that we're trialing out something to test in humans. So there is a drug or something that we need to test to see if it changes something in people that have Huntington's disease. So that could be a pill, it could be an injection, it could be what we call an intrathecal injection, which is when you get a drug that's injected through the spine, like through a lumbar puncture or a spinal tap. Yeah, there's varying levels of, you know, ways we can get drugs into humans. So that's what I like to focus on, clinical trials. Some people think use the word trials when they really are talking about something called observational research. And the clue's in the name, it's where we are just observing people. And that's people that are healthy versus people that have Huntington's disease or have symptoms or maybe carry a gene, to see what are the differences in any way we observe them. So it could be from blood tests, it could be from brain scans, where we can image the brain and get real detailed pictures of what's actually happening inside the brain. We also have lumbar punctures and spinal taps to look for things in what we call the spinal fluid, to see if there's molecular and biological changes that are different from controls and people that carry the gene. And then maybe Kelly, you want to tell us a bit more about kind of other ways we can test people, like cognitive testing and thinking?
Yeah, for sure. So, I mean, Lauren's talked a lot about how we might use imaging, the brain scans, or we might use biomarkers, which can be things like blood, or it can be the CSF in the brain, the spinal cord. But with observational studies, often we're also looking at how people's thinking might change over time and how their behavior might change over time. And those things can be surveys, they can be questionnaires, it can be thinking and memory tests that you might do with somebody. It can be observations of someone's behavior in a clinic room or a research room. So they're more, I guess, they're less invasive ways that we might look at someone's change over time in terms of their behavior or their thinking. And we would do that as part of an observational study. And sometimes we also use that as part of a clinical trial. So sometimes the outcome of the study or of a particular drug might be whether there's been a change in thinking or whether there's been a change in function or a change in mood. And so sometimes those kinds of tools that I've worked on have been used in as outcome measures, or as the sort of the outcome that we're going to assess whether the drug or the intervention was successful or not. I think the other thing, just with the clinical trials we talked about, you know, we talked a lot about drugs and we talked a lot about, different ways that drugs might be administered. And in Huntington's disease, that makes a lot of sense. That's often what clinical trials are in HD. But there are other types of clinical trials that don't involve drugs. So, for example, I've worked in clinical trials where we've looked at different models of care, where somebody gets one model of care. So they might get, you know, they might get a certain set of therapies from different health professionals, and another group might just get you know, our current standard of care. And that helps us understand whether these different pathways of care, whether one's better than the other. And that's also a clinical trial. So really, when we're talking about clinical trials, we're talking about two groups of people who are randomized to do different interventions. And then we compare those two interventions on our outcome of interest. And the intervention can be lots of different things. It can be a drug, but it can also be other things.
I think that's a really important point, especially understanding the many changes when it comes to cognitive functionality and Huntington's disease and emotional changes because of the, you know, whether it's abuse or traumatic situations coming from a Huntington's disease family. And as people seemingly progress, for example, if they're testing positive, are these earlier behavioral symptoms or are these symptoms that anybody who's gone through trauma has faced? It's important to understand those things. So I think that's a really important piece to bring up about the different types of clinical trials and what intervention really means. Because I do think we assume one way or the other.
And one thing to kind of highlight there is that, you know, with it, this testing and intervention, we are doing it what researchers call prospectively. So you plan ahead of time and you're putting people into two groups and testing something on them to see if it changes the outcome. Whereas when we do observational research, we might look for things that actually happened to them in their past, but it's still observational because we're observing their history, and you might hear terms like natural history of Huntington's disease. And that's what that means. We're trying to really understand, you know, are there clues in what's the factors and other things that are special about these people that have done, that have, say, have a later disease onset than people, these other people? Is there things that we, clues that can tell us other things that influence Huntington's disease that are already, we could already know, and that would lead us to new potential targets to test in the clinical trials in the future?
Yeah, and I think, you know, some of the challenges that we have with Huntington's disease is that with trials specifically, you're looking for a very small targeted population and community to participate. And so you have access issues, you have potential disease progression or haven't progressed yet or are at risk or are gene negative, so you can't always participate. But this observational study tends to be a little bit broader. And a lot of the different cases, especially thinking of Enroll HD, where you can have many different community members participate. And I think it's important to understand the importance of that, because what's been mentioned but hasn't we haven't explained yet is the fact of having kind of the control community, which are people unaffected biologically by Huntington's disease, who to see how their brain is developing and changing over time compared to people who are gene positive or are at risk, to be able to make those comparisons, and the importance of people to still participate even if they have not tested gene positive.
I think that's a really important point, because unfortunately with clinical trials, we need to know that these people have Huntington's disease, otherwise it wouldn't be ethical to give them a treatment that we don't know if it's going to be unsafe. I think it's less risky, obviously, when you're doing less invasive procedures and interventions like some of the things that Kelly mentioned, but a lot of these new drugs that are being developed for Huntington's are very invasive and very new ways of treating diseases, and we're trying to get into the brain and make changes there, so the risk is really high. So we really need to make sure people have the gene or, you know, healthy otherwise than their Huntington's. And it's why it's so frustrating that there's so many, you know, criteria that people have to go through to get into trials. It's not just about the, you know, whether they have the disease, but they need to make sure they don't have other things that might make it harder to interpret the results. And they also want to make sure, which we haven't really touched on, is that we're going to measure, be able to measure changes in those outcomes that Kelly mentioned earlier. So I think
quick changes too, because you don't want to put people through too long of a trial because of the many, especially in Huntington's disease, it can be slow progressing, but there can be really periods of fast progressing and a lot of different changes that can happen. And you don't want to burden the participants.
Yeah. And that's been a frustrating thing. And one of these reasons why, you know, we're not yet doing trials in people that don't have symptoms yet, because how are we going to show if that drug works? Because we need to know, you know, it could be 10, 20 years before they have symptoms. You know, we really need to get better at understanding the most subtle and earliest changes before people ever get symptoms to even be able to conduct trials and show that a drug's working. Otherwise, we'd need thousands and thousands of people, which really isn't feasible financially, or just having enough people around the world with Huntington's disease to run these trials.
And that kind of leads to the intersection of how this all works. How do people then, how do companies know what these biomarkers are in these slow progressions? And that's young people participating in observational trials, so we can understand what is happening to young adults before symptoms occur. So then that way clinical trials could be developed for this younger population. Mm-hmm. Kelly, I've seen you wanting to chomp at the bit and answer, and I just interrupted you.
No, it's totally fine. I think I totally agree with everything we're saying. I think it's one of the real challenges that we have at the moment. And it's what a lot of the work that I've done has focused on is how do we design tools, you know, measures that are sensitive enough to some of these changes that are so subtle and so slow, particularly, you know, in those early stages of disease or even before anyone has symptoms of disease. How do we measure some of those changes that we know might be happening in the brain? Really challenging.
And I guess that's a nice segue on to kind of explaining biomarkers a bit more. We talked about it a bit, but so biomarkers are anything biological that you can quantify in a human. So that could be anything in the blood. It could be the brain scans that and the pictures that we can measure. And there's things that we use in our standards of care for other things. You know, you go to the doctor and get a health check and they measure your glucose or your cholesterol levels. They're all biomarkers that give information to clinicians or physicians on whether, you know, how healthy you are, you know, for heart disease and things. And that's because there's tons of research that's been done and trials that know that those biomarkers tell us something about, you know, the prognosis of someone's. So there's lots of different ways that biomarkers can be used. So I just mentioned one as a prognostic biomarker. It could be also used as an outcome measure in trials. So we could use a biomarker change that might be more sensitive and maybe happening before the clinical change, and we call that situation a surrogate. So it's kind of, if we know that biomarker changing is a good thing and will predict, you know, the future clinical benefit, then it becomes a surrogate endpoint or outcome measure. You can also have safety biomarkers, so things that, you know, are indicators that this drug's not doing good things. So there's been some talks, you know, there is some side effects in certain trials where, you know, there might be, they talk about ventricular expansion, what's a ventricle, but that's basically the where the fluid in the CSF and the brain is. We have these little reservoirs or cavities in the brain, and in Huntington's disease in general, they get bigger because of there's brain cell loss or atrophy, and in certain trials they've seen, you know, those getting bigger with the drug that was suggesting that that's not a good thing. There's been things like protein going up in the spinal fluid, which, and other markers of inflammation, which tell us that, okay, the brain's not happy here, we need to stop the drug. And that's where we've seen situations where trials might have been stopped early for that reason. So they're really useful in a multitude of ways, and it really kind of emphasizes the importance of us really understanding what is going on biologically in people that carry the gene, and brings us back to, you know, participating in observational research. So we have these big kind of global thing, studies, research studies like Enroll HD or HD Clarity. So Enroll HD is kind of the global study that anybody who's in a HD family or a relative or spouse can take part in. You know, you don't have to be tested to take part either. So it's a good avenue if you're really not sure about getting tested or don't ever want to get tested, but still would like to get involved and contribute in some way. that is a great place to start. And there's lots of sites worldwide, and we can share kind of links of how you could get involved.
I should say not only do you not have to be tested, as you won't be told what your status is. They do test for it, but your data is randomized. It's connected to you, but it's de-identified. So at no point will someone say to you on a chart, okay, I see that you've tested positive if you're at risk. That conversation doesn't happen.
Yeah, exactly. And I've worked in studies, and I think Kelly has, where we do enroll visits, we take somebody's blood, they get sent to a biorepository in Italy, and they test it there, and no one at the study team who has contact with you directly would ever know what your result is. We don't get any information back. This just goes into a huge database that researchers can apply to use, but anything that gets shared in the future is completely de-identified, and so no one can trace it back to you.
Just diving into the biomarkers too, I just wanted to note, in our Breaking Down Barrier series, we did a breakdown of biomarkers with Professor Sarah Tabrisi and one of our ambassadors, Molly. So that's a good place to look at a whole session devoted to biomarkers, but continuing to learn is really important, because while we did that in about an hour, you could talk about biomarkers for days. So it's a continual learning process, but that's another great place to get resources on that.
I certainly could, but then I'm
I want to talk about, so we've talked about observational studies, we've talked about clinical trials, we've talked about what those look like. But then we also have registries and surveys, and there are a lot of them out there. And I know that there is such a thing as survey and registry fatigue, which is a real thing, but these mechanisms are really important, especially when you look at access challenges, when you're thinking of if you live in an environment or a country or a city or in a rural community where you don't have access to any observational studies, you don't qualify for clinical trial, there may not be clinical trials in your area. What can you do to provide valuable insight? And that's where these surveys and registries really come into play. And they're not, as for lack of a better word, sexy as going into the office, and you don't necessarily feel like you're participating in research, but man, your stories have power. And the sheer reality is we have to have numbers to be able to show the community's perspective. And we all hear anecdotally from the community about their experiences, but when we're thinking about big change happening, we need to have those larger numbers, and those surveys and registries are that mechanism to be able to cascade to a larger audience, to be able to bring the community together. Mm-hmm. Kelly, I know you're currently, you've built a registry. We're looking at other surveys and opportunities at HDYO. What are your thoughts?
Yeah, I think lots of thoughts similar to Lauren's biomarker thoughts. I'll try to rein it in. But I think I think the surveys and the registries and some of these other questionnaire sort of based studies are a really good way to start engaging in research. They're such a good, entry into what research might look like. And you're so right that, they're not as maybe, for lack of a better word, sexy as going in and doing some of those more invasive studies. But they provide so much valuable information, and they are so useful for researchers. I always think of them as sort of like one, we talk about this pipeline. You probably hear this euphemism used all the time, like this drug pipeline, and, we'll get, we have things in the works. And really these studies are like one part of that pipe. And the reason that they're important is, for example, in some of the work that I've done, which has been sort of at a single site, so a single site sort of study, and it could be observational. For example, I might have asked people to complete a survey on their mood, for example. And then from those surveys, I'm able to say, okay, this is a valid way of measuring mood in HD. And then that's really useful for the site, the people that are running things like Enroll or some of these other clinical trials, to say, okay, this is a tool that we might be able to use that's sensitive. And so those sort of single site studies contribute to those bigger studies in terms of how they're designed, what kinds of measures are used, how many people are recruited. So all of those smaller studies that you might participate in do have really important flow-on effects for those larger studies that are run across multiple sites. So that's, you know, one of the reasons that they're really important. And there's you know, lots of reasons why we really value them. And another one, you know, from a registry point of view, is it helps us understand where people are and what they have access to. And if we're thinking about where these trials are going to be run, people that are putting the money into these trials need to know that there's people that live there that have the disease or the condition of interest. And so they want to make sure that there's people that are going to participate in their trials. And so those registries can provide really useful information about where people live. And we can lobby and say, oh, hey, there's lots of people here that have, you know, this particular, you know, that are affected by HD. This would be a great place to have one of these trials. And so that's another reason why the registries are really beneficial. So even though they might feel small and they might not feel like they're contributing to these big sort of larger studies that you hear a lot about in the news, they actually are contributing in a really valuable way.
I would say
HD research.
Yeah, I was going to say, on top of it, they're also valuable to associations for advocacy efforts.
Yeah.
So, for example, with our research survey series that we do at HDYO, our first survey was looking at how are people seeking out for information and support. And the reason that's important is for us to be able to do better as advocacy organizations to say, you know, we're hearing from these community members based off of regions of the world, based off of how they're identifying, whatever we need to look at. How people are finding out that information so we can use those platforms to better disseminate educational information, support information, all of these different things. And so, again, we can make best guesses based off of who is the loudest in the room at the time sharing their opinions and experiences. But is, you know, are those few people who are speaking up the whole community? Maybe, maybe not, but we need to be able to gauge that on larger numbers so we can do better for advocacy and support as well.
I guess this might be important just to clarify kind of what a registry is, because it, you know, it can take many shapes and forms, and it doesn't necessarily have to be a small, because quite often they can get bigger, and just some of the efforts that we're doing are trying to make more global efforts. But I think on the most basic level, they might just be a sign up for people to say, hey, I'm here, I'm involved, I want to be, you know, give me more information. But they can also take forms where, you know, clinicians might add information from their clinical population that they treat. You know, they might add your clinical information into a registry, so it all feeds into that trying to understand numbers of where people are, what their care needs are, and quite often they use things that we call patient or participant reported measures. So that's where surveys are that it's where you get a chance to kind of answer questions in your own on your own accord, and sometimes in your own words, which are slightly different from what we do in some of the observational studies, where a person might ask you questions about how you deal with certain things. So there's just different ways of getting information that are both useful in their own ways.
Absolutely. And I think with registries and surveys, they tend to be much more convenient. And that was to Kelly's point about being your first kind of toe dip into the bigger ocean of research, are these opportunities, because you can do it from your phone at your home in your convenience, at your convenience, especially for families impacted by Huntington's disease. Time is really precious, and you don't always have a lot of time when you're actively caring for others or what have you. And so that convenience factor is really beneficial to make a big impact as well. Well, so it's all good and well to say how great research is and the importance, but there are some real barriers that we face when you're thinking about participating, whether these are unintentionally laid stigmas from years of cultural challenges and experiences when it comes to research, when it comes to access, when it comes to religion, when it comes to logistics around participating. So I wanted to kind of break down some of these stigmas that we know that are in existence, because there have been surveys and studies, aka research, done on what the HD community faces when thinking about some of these components. So I wanted to start off with the biggest one that many people think about with clinical trials. So Kelly and Lauren, what are some of the, especially, you know, Kelly, knowing, you know, your field of neuropsychology, what are some of those psychological barriers or physical barriers that we see from the community when they think about participating in research?
Gosh, big question. You know, I think there's lots of different barriers, and you've sort of highlighted those already. So there's I guess the first thing we'll say, there's practical barriers, right? So if you don't live near a site, that's a really practical barrier that's very difficult to, you know, that's a very challenging thing to overcome. If you don't have time off from work, that's another practical barrier that can be really challenging for people. And we know from some of our own surveys that we've done at the survey series of HDYO that those things are a real barrier for people. Mm-hmm. And then we also know that there are some, as you mentioned, Jenna, psychological barriers, and they can be things like feeling anxious about what it would mean to participate, whether it is, you know, being anxious about what will actually happen, you know, if you're taking a new study drug and you feel people might feel uneasy about that. People can often be uneasy about different medical procedures. As Lauren's highlighted, some of the ways that we administer these drugs can be quite invasive. And if you've not been around that a lot, it can seem pretty daunting. So, you know, that's another sort of aspect of it. And then there's, you know, challenges around what it might mean to be enrolled in one of these trials and how that, what that looks like in terms of, being someone who's might be labeled as having a disease or an illness, and that's another really big challenge for people. And obviously there's some challenges around whether or not you want to be tested to see what your genetic status is, and often for the clinical trials that's a requirement, is that we have that genetic status information. So There are lots of barriers. Some of them are practical and logistical, and then some of them are more emotional and psychological. And mm-hmm. we've seen from our results that both of those things are experienced by the community and in varying ways. You know, I think the clinical trials in particular are often associated with some anxiety around the procedures, which mm-hmm. makes complete sense. Whereas we see more of the logistical barriers perhaps getting in the way for people in terms of the observational studies. Does that answer that sort of question?
Yeah. Well, I think too, the fear, the psychological, that fear is really there, especially with observational studies, because as we've talked about, it can be seen as a progression where even by answering questions on your phone, you might be thinking, who has access to this data? Am I outing myself if I am looking at insurance challenges, or will I be discriminated at work if this information gets out there? And I think those are really important questions to have at the forefront. So if you're participating in a survey, it's very, you know, and that's a really basic way of participating in research, ask them. Who owns my data? How is my data going to be managed? What if I don't want to participate any longer? Like, you're allowed to ask those questions. And then it gets even more complicated as you get deeper into the research. But taking that first step to participating and saying, I exist in this community and I'm going to provide my feedback, is really challenging sometimes for people. And it's a huge step forward, but those fears really lay out there, especially if you come from a family where Huntington's disease can be stigmatized.
Yeah. The other thing, you know, with all these trials is that you'll, you know, there's always a consent process, and, you know, you'll get given a form of varying lengths, and, you know, sometimes people read it, sometimes they don't, but that consent, whenever you're given that consent form, or you go through the consent procedures, that really is the best time to start asking some of these questions. And no question is a silly question, right? And at no point should you feel pressured to, I mean, I know sometimes when people give me forms and I have to sign, I feel like pressure to sign it rather than making them sit there and wait while I read through page after page. But it's just not the case with these things. You can take as much time as you need to read it if you want to, and which, you know, you're obviously encouraged to do, but but you know, also asking questions of the researcher and asking them to go through the consent form with you and make sure that they've talked to you about all of the things that are in that form if you don't want to sit there and read it alone. That's what they're there for.
And usually with any kind of observational study or trial where they may be you may have an ID or your name's associated with it, other unlike say surveys that might be done completely anonymously, there is no requirement that you have a right to withdraw from any study and have your data deleted or removed or anything. That there is some stipulations that, like, if it's after the point where they've already analyzed and shared the data with someone, usually an anonymous or most certainly in a anonymized way or de-identified way, but that should be stipulated in the informed consent procedure that you have that right to, you know, if you change your mind in the future, that's completely valid. Another kind of worry I think a lot of that comes up, particularly for younger population that are before symptoms, who may be gene positive and symptom hunting and quite anxious about getting when they're going to get Huntington's disease, a lot of them do have a lot of anxieties about coming to clinic and getting tested and doing these assessments that might make them remind them that they're at risk for Huntington's disease or that their symptoms. Certainly with one of my own studies, we have recruited people from the HDYO young adult study, which is at UCL, under Sarah Tabrizi, but that population are far from onset of Huntington's disease, and we've invited them to take to do a self blood test. So they use a finger prick to collect blood, and they send that in their own home, and they send that to us every 2 months. But we're finding there's a few of those people have dropped out. Not a lot. Most people keep going because it's an amazing community, and it is quite easy, a lot easier to do it at home rather than come in to the clinic. But I think the frequency of, you know, being reminded that, you know, about Huntington's disease can be a lot. And particularly if you're thinking about clinical trials, which usually involve a lot more visits and coming to the clinic and much more tests, that's something to think about. Whereas most observational studies might be one visit a year or two visits a year, which is, I think, a bit more bearable than more intense studies like clinical trials. So there's a lot of factors that come into it.
That's a really good point, Lauren. Yeah, we've seen a little bit of that in our survey series as well, and some of the sort of when people have a chance to write about what their experience has been, you know, that sense of it being a little bit being a reminder and making people think about things that they actually would prefer not to in their day-to-day life. That's another challenge.
I think that's where the importance of building your support system is so important, whether that's relying on the support system built, for example, if you're in an observational study, who are the investigators? What is their structure like? Do they have social workers who are there or therapists who could be made available? And those are also questions to ask for clinical trials to say, what levels of support do you offer for participating? Harder to do so when you're in a survey because there is that barrier that is sometimes more convenient and more appealing because you're not having to necessarily outwardly label yourself to the community, but know that you've got support through HDYO, through other associations. So as things happen and, you know, and it's hard to know when you're going to get triggered if you do, or if you're leading up to an enroll HD appointment, maybe reach out to be able to say, I'm starting to feel a little bit of anxiety for my yearly appointment, because it does happen where people are going into their enroll appointment. And if they're gene positive or at risk, they may be thinking, is this going to be the day that they tell me that I have symptoms, which I think is also a fear, which is not the intent of enroll HD. And so it does build up really easily and quickly sometimes. So really building that support system around you is going to be really important, which I don't think is always thought of when you're participating in research.
I mean, if that ever does happen that you get told at an enroll visit, that shouldn't happen. It should be in a clinical visit, which should be, they might you might have a clinical visit and an enroll visit
yep.
on the same day together, but that should be purely with your doctor when you're talking about your clinical care. So if it is ever happened to you, I would report it. Talk to us and we can feed that back to enroll HD. But it shouldn't happen like that. We've experienced a lot of our participants really enjoying being involved in research and engaging with the team, because at least, you know, my experience coming from a HD family, I was really, before I came to UCL, I felt very not suspicious, but skeptical of clinicians and nurses and stuff, because a lot of people I'd engaged with growing up did not even know what Huntington's was, or really poorly understood it, or knew the wrong thing and wrong stigmas on it. So it's really refreshing to be in specialist centers, and not everyone has that, you know, privilege to be near centers like UCL, but meeting a team that actually understands the disease in a lot deeper way was a really huge thing for me. And I think from my experience talking to our participants, they really enjoy having that understanding and being able to talk about their experiences. Can be a part of that support network as well. Yeah, that's thing. And one thing about clinical trials as well, a lot of people do really well in clinical trials because their care is probably better. They're being seen by clinicians all the time, and their care and their well-being gets reviewed all the time. So it's another factor of like when trials stop or after the trial, there can be a bit of a loss there, because, you know, there can be a lot of benefits of taking part in a trial just for the fact that you get more interactions with the clinical team.
I think too, one thing to quickly mention before I move on to, I think part of that fear is also the fear of rejection. So you're putting yourself out there for the first time and saying, this is who I am. And then to get turned away at the door because you don't meet requirements, whether it's in a clinical trial or specific observational study or what have you, I think that fear of rejection is a real thing too.
I never thought about it that way, but that's so true.
Well, we talked about a lot of different opportunities out there, and part of the challenge is this lack of awareness. And there's a lot of complications that come through that. And I think that also ties in with some of the work that we're doing with our research survey series, as we're looking at how are people seeking information, what are the validated resources? Because I think it's also important to understand the many complexities of the HD community, because you have a high number of people untested. You have a high number of young people who find out about Huntington's disease at variations of different times in their life, and things are happening behind the scenes because it's not just Huntington's disease that's going on. And so you have this community of people who are kind of following along at an arm's length, for many reasons, who are just waiting for that first time to feel comfortable and safe to reach out for whatever means that is, whether that's for support or to comment or like something on social media, whether that's going in to confidentially talk about genetic testing or what have you, many different topics. But there is this lack of awareness because of these many different disconnects in the community because of these stigmas built in. And so I think that really, and that kind of lays into some of the work that we're trying to look into, which are those emotional and educational barriers around participating research and access to information. And I know, Kelly, we just released this survey in January, so it's really new, but what are some of the just generalization that we're hearing from young people and young adults globally on what some of those things are?
Yeah, so, you know, I think in terms of the barriers that people are facing.
Yeah, what about even some of the educational barriers? So even thinking about lack of awareness and educational pieces that we're seeing.
Yeah, so aside from some of, so with this survey series, what we did is we looked at some of the practical barriers, and then we also asked people just generally, what do you know about these topics? And so we had a list of all of these different sort of terms. And Lauren and I have actually used a whole bunch of them in this call, and I've been really mindful of it. So, you know, we're using all these terms, and the press releases are using all of these terms, but do people actually know what they mean? And the answer, kind of long and short, is that not really. People are pretty uncertain of what these terms are. And so, you know, we asked basic things like, do people know what observational studies are? Do they know what interventional studies are? And those ones, you know, people have a bit more confidence with, but still a lot of people aren't really sure. And then some of these other terms that we're using, like outcome measures, primary endpoints, inclusion criteria, data monitoring, people just don't really understand what they are. And so there's a real disconnect between what us researchers are talking about and the language that we're speaking versus what the community who might want to participate understand and the language that they're speaking. And we're really trying to bridge that gap so that there is less of a barrier between what we're saying and what people are understanding. Mm. And that's been a big part of this survey that we released in January. And that's a really important thing for us to know, because we're making these kinds of videos that are supposed to break down barriers. But also it's really helpful for us as an advocacy group to be able to say to some of these other organizations and industry partners, hey, actually, that just doesn't really make sense to people. That's not the way to explain what these trials are or what these studies are. And this is the language, actually, that you know, we should use different language. And also we should help people understand what these terms mean. So both bringing people up so that they understand what we're talking about, but also being mindful of the language that we're using when we're talking about research.
I don't know about you all, but I am not a scientist by training, by people who are watching. So when I go to a big science conference and they're talking about these really in-depth, even when they're talking about clinical trial inclusion criteria, and you have acronyms out the wazoo and all of these different things, and you're trying to figure out what are you actually talking about, you tend to stumble and you get focused on these things that you don't know, that it's impossible to retain the information that's important. And especially when you're thinking about inclusion and exclusion criteria, because being someone impacted, you may say, is that me? And so then you get hyper-focused on the, is this me or my loved one? You know, how does that affect my family? So it does get really challenging to listen to research presentations. And so by participating in the survey, again, as Kelly said, we can break this all down to say, this information is the most important to have on this first conversation level to basically understand what's going on. And then as the conversation develops, or as the presentation develops, or if people ask more about this, then you can bring in X, Y, and Z that are a little bit more specific. And it's not to hide information, it's just to help with that retention and that comprehension of what's being told. Because if you're not first meeting that need, then you're not fully understanding the whole aspect of it. And honestly, at our HDYO Congress being held in Prague, shameful plug, March of 2025, hdyocongress.org. One of our first sessions we're doing on that second day, that main education day, is we're actually going to be breaking down research terminology for the whole group and doing an interactive game with it with all 300 to 400 people. And having a glossary of terms. So then that way you can sit in those presentations, use the information, you will have heard the information. And so when you're sitting in scientific presentation, you'll have a better preparation to absorb or ask questions or have follow-up conversations with these partners to create that better, well-educated, well-empowered community to get more and more involved and ask those questions. Because those questions are also a barrier, because sometimes you may feel stupid because you don't know, but you don't know if you don't ask questions.
Yeah, and it's such a good point there. Sorry, Lauren. I was just going to say, you know, if one thing has come out from this survey, it's that if you don't understand a term, you are absolutely not alone in not understanding that term. This is not a you specific issue. This is actually something that we as a research organization, you know, as a research group within HD, need to get better at making sure that what we're communicating, it makes sense.
I was going to add that it's not just non-scientific people that find
certain, I was going to say that too. I had the exact
presentation. Not everyone's good at making their research accessible, because even when we go to research conferences, we all have different types of research specialties, and people aren't very good at giving the high level why should I care speech. But just so you, so if to make people feel better, it's not, it's we all suffer.
It's not 100%. An intellect difference. It's not an intellectual difference. It's
a jargon. It's just jargon that, you know, we are so used to hearing, but we need to be more mindful.
And it's overwhelming for community members. Yeah, it's a different language. It's emotional. I was, after one of our research presentations at Congress last year, I stopped someone and we were just talking, and they said, I finally feel hopeful. They had just lost their father, you know, so there's this emotional tie that research plays in. And I think when you're living and eating and breathing research, it's very easy to cut that off and not always consider that, but that's the reality of the Huntington's disease community. So it is important to have that sensitivity, that empathy, that elevated understanding versus just getting the information out there. It's how can you make it more tangible and manageable?
Yeah, 100%.
Well, as we wrap up this conversation, I would love for both of you to kind of close thoughts and you know, what you would say to young people, HD community members who are fearful or just have questions about participating in research or just kind of trying to figure out, is it right for them? What are some things that you would say for them as they go through that decision-making process?
I'd say talk to HDYO, because there's a lot of young people and ambassadors that have take part in research studies and probably every type of kind of way of participating. So there's lots of people you could be connected with to ask questions. Just reach out. There's definitely people around the world. That's the power of social media and networks, that, you know, we can be more connected and being empowered to have that information that we need.
Yeah, it's hard to finish after Lauren, but I would say that, you know, I would say start small and start with what feels accessible to you. And if that is filling out an online survey, then that's a fantastic first step. I think doing what feels right for you and doing what you feel is comfortable for you at where you're at is really important. And managing maybe some of that, asking yourself, am I doing this because I want to do this, or am I doing this because I feel like I should do this? And really the question, the answer is always that, you know, it's wonderful if you feel like you can participate in research, but there's no obligation to participate in research. Mm-hmm. And I think that's really important. You know, we talk a lot about encouraging people, and I desperately want to encourage people to participate in research as a researcher, but also it really isn't an obligation. It's really only if it's something that feels right for you and ready for you. And it's not something that you have to do just because you're part of the HD community. There's lots of ways to be involved in the community. Some of them are research and some of them are other things, and that's okay.
I think changing the word encouraging to empowering, because that's really the crux of it. Because it is an encouragement if it's right for them, but it's also empowering through education to be able to say, here are the resources available when it's convenient, when you have time. Let's talk about it, review it yourself or what have you, to make that best decision. Because that's essentially exactly what you're saying. And I love all of that, because it is a very personal decision, and you should not feel pressured. And I think that if you do feel pressured, then that's definitely not the research for you, because that's not a supportive environment. And as we've mentioned, there are so many layers to Huntington's disease. You need to take care of yourself, treasure your mental health, your emotional well-being. There's a lot of things happening behind the scenes that the research community doesn't see. So, you know, if it feels icky, don't do it. It's fine to step back. But if it feels like a safe environment, continue to ask questions and continue to learn more to see if that's a good decision for you. Well, thank you both so much for your time today. This is an important conversation and we'll continue to have these conversations. And there are a lot of resources available on hdyo.org, including our research tab, which has conversational ways of talking about clinical trials, observational studies, as well as learning more about our research survey series, which is international and in almost a dozen different languages, which is really exciting and available for anybody 18 and older impacted by Huntington's disease. So thank you, Callie. Thank you, Lauren. And thank you most importantly to the HD community, and we'll see you soon.